Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the first Coffee with the Playhouse of 2021. We're so glad to have you here. My name is Gabriel Green. I am the Director of Artistic Development at the Playhouse, and we have a fantastic show for you today. Our Artistic Director, Christopher Ashley, will be in conversation with Idris Goodwin, the playwright of this year's pop tour for young audiences titled Pick Me Last, as well as the director of that play, Jacole Kitchen, who is also the Playhouse's Artistic Programs Manager and Local Casting Director, and Bridget Cavaiola, who is our Director of Education and Outreach. But before we get to all of that, we are going to do our customary trivia game. You can send the answers to these questions to marketing@ljp.org and be entered into an opportunity drawing to win a $10 gift card. So without any further ado, let's see the questions. What former La Jolla Playhouse artistic director wrote the very first performance outreach program tour in 1987? 33 years the program has been in existence. And we are very excited. It's going to be a completely new one this year, as you'll hear later in this interview. It's going to be the first time it isn't touring live in schools, but we're very excited about what we've cooked up instead. Let's see the second question. What Tony Award-winning actor co-wrote and directed the 2016 pop tour, Alice Chan? It is an actor who's also appeared in a Playhouse show before. I'm thinking back, I want to say it was about 8 or 9 years ago, he performed in a solo show, and then he returned as an artist in residence a few years ago, during which time he co-wrote this pop tour. All right, final question. This is a good preparation for what you do after this final question. Jacole Kitchen, one of today's guests and director of this year's pop tour, also directed which previous pop tour production? It was just a couple of years ago, a fantastic play by a playwright named Laura Shellhart. That's the only clue I'm going to give you. The answers might come up during the conversation. Keep your ears open. All right, now here's what you do to be entered for that card. Email your answers to marketing@ljp.org and you will be automatically entered. Thank you all so much. It gives me great pleasure to introduce our marketing director. Sorry, I did it again, Debbie. I keep wanting to push you into marketing. I think you have a talent for it. Please welcome our managing director, Debbie Buchholz.
Thank you, Gabe. I do not have a talent for it. We have an outstanding marketing director in Mia Fiorello, and that is not where I should be. But thank you. Happy New Year, everyone, and good morning. I am Debbie Buchholz, the managing director of La Jolla Playhouse. And it's a pleasure to welcome you to our January Coffee with the Playhouse. You know, actually, over the last 10 months, we've started a whole lot of conversations internally and externally with the phrase, you know, in these unprecedented times. And all the way through, it's been true. And I think, though, that there's kind of no more time of unprecedented time than where that expression is true than right now. And frankly, it's at a time like that where I'm just so privileged to be able and grateful to be able to be involved in a conversation like this one that we're having today. You know, art, particularly theater art, is really an agent of healing and understanding. And it brings us all together for conversation, helping us to celebrate the things we all have in common and understand the things that we have that are different. And honestly, nothing could be more representative than the pop tour. It's a project that the Playhouse undertakes every year, and we have for over 35 years now, with a new piece of theater that's meant to introduce children to live theater and to encourage what theater does. It engages us in conversation about how to understand each other, how to make the world better. And I can't think of a better time to have that conversation than right now. Before I turn it over to Chris Ashley, who will lead us, as he always does, so expertly in these conversations, I want to remind you about our Digital Without Walls offering, right now. Some of our current projects include Taxilandia, which is a project that explores the notion of our neighborhoods and gentrification, and then A Thousand Ways, which is a three-piece project that kicks off with a telephone conversation between two patrons who are unknown to each other and then are guided by prompts in a conversation that fosters connection in this very isolating time. So I hope that you will join us for those projects, that you'll check out the other projects that are still available on our website. And it's now my pleasure to introduce our very own Christopher Ashley, the Rich Family Artistic Director of La Jolla Playhouse, to kick off our conversation with some very exciting artists. Good morning, Chris.
Good morning, Debbie. Thank you very much. And thank you for your very well said introduction. I'm talking to you from up in the Bay Area. It's called the Skywalker Ranch, and it's a sound mix facility that was originally created to mix the early Star Wars movies. If you notice all the sort of sound equipment in the back, it's because we're mixing the Netflix movie of Diana. I can't think of, I'm bouncing around. I can't think of three artists I would rather have a conversation with today than Idris and Jacole and Bridget. Our guests include the renowned playwright, educator, and author of our 2021 Performance Outreach Program. It's Idris Goodwin, and he's going to be joined by Jacole Kitchen, the Playhouse Artistic Programs Manager, and also our local casting director. And she's also directing this year's pop tour, and Bridget Cavaiola, our interim director of education and outreach at the Playhouse. So let's bring them all to the screen while that's happening. Good morning, Idris. Good morning, Bridget. Good morning, Jacole. Well, we're going to be talking about this year's pop tour, along as well as many other things. Idris not only wrote this year's Pick Me Last, but also wrote one of the 10-minute plays for our Play at Home series for young audiences, which was entitled Lost and Found Nation. He's a breakbeat poet, podcast host, a director of the Colorado Springs Fine Arts Center at Colorado College. He sits on the advisory board for Theater for Young Audiences USA and the Children's Theater Foundation Association. You're incredibly well-rounded, Idris, and thank you for joining us today.
It's great to be here. Thank you for that introduction. Fun fact, I am also well-rounded because of my sweet tooth.
Excellent. Good to know. We'll continue that. We'll fold that into the conversation today as well. I'm going to start with a question for Bridget. Could you give us a little brief history of the pop tour? How did it begin at the Playhouse? How many students has it reached over the years? Just give us a little overview of pop tour at the Playhouse.
Sure. Good morning, everybody. So as we heard a little bit earlier from Gabe and Debbie, the performance outreach program, the pop tour, has been a part of our season programming for 34 years. So 1987 is when we started. And the first pop tour was called Silent Edward. And it was written, the book, music, and lyrics was written by our former artistic director, Des Mechanoff, who many of you know. And that was actually a musical about a ferry boat race. And it was about environmental issues. It was about personal integrity. It was about being a good member of a community. And that helped set the platform for what we try to do each year with the Pop Tour, which is think about what are the issues, what are the themes that relate to young people, and how can we introduce theater to them in their own spaces? So in their cafeterias, in their gymnasiums, as we tour around San Diego County. We typically write our pop tour for elementary school students, grades 3 through 6. And we introduce them to all of the elements of theater. So not just what it's like to be a performer, but we create curriculum around what it's like to be a playwright, who is a director, who is a costume designer, and they get to interact with these folks throughout the process. So we reach around 10,000 students all over San Diego County each year. So if my math is correct, in that amount of time, we've reached 330,000 young folks through the pop tour. And some of those young folks are now in their 30s and hopefully thinking about that experience and how the arts had an impact on them, even if they're not working directly in the arts, that they had this opportunity to engage that way. And for many young folks, it's their first time, which is very exciting.
Love that. Question for Idris. Talk to us about your play, Pick Me Last. What's it about? And why did you want to tell that story right now?
So I was watching Top Chef, and they were having restaurant wars. And they usually do restaurant wars, I think, when they're down like to like the last 8 or 10, something like that. And they split them into two teams. And whoever's been like kicking the most butt throughout the season become like the team captain. So they get to pick from everyone else, right? So if there's 10 people, so they pull out 2, then there's 8 other people who are standing there. And on this episode, someone got picked last. And she said, this is an adult saying, nobody likes to be picked last, but you know, I'm gonna show them. And I was just like, wow, that feeling never goes away. You know, we think that that's just like when you're a kid and you're playing, you know, kickball or something like that. But even when you're an adult, like, you don't like to get picked last. So I was just interested in that. Like, what is that about? And why do we do that? Like, who came up with this idea of like team captains and like, you two are the most special and you get the power and you get to pick everybody. So I started doing research and I read a quote from this very, very accomplished, you know, woman who still had sores and wounds from when she was picked last as a kid. She was like, it never left. I mean, now some could argue that's why she's so accomplished now, because she was like this person who got picked last on Top Chef. She's like, I'll show them, you know. So, you know, and I always start a play with the question, you know. So that was kind of the question of like, you know, why do we do this? What does it mean? And then the story started to materialize. And so this story is about a group of kids, and it's about a young lady in particular who's sick of seeing her very good friend always picked last. And she's just learned about the butterfly effect, which is basically the concept that everything we do is connected. And so like a small thing that you do right now will have, can have repercussions, you know, 10, 13, 15 times removed from you. And so she is thoroughly convinced that if her friend Wes gets picked last again, it's going to ruin his entire life. And so she puts a whole strategy into play to just for her to get picked last instead of him. And so throughout the play, we watch, and the play is very like, very sort of like, you know, like I try, when I write plays for young audiences, I try to evoke the energy of a young person. I live with young people, very young people. And they have a way that they experience the world. They have a pace that they go at. Their brain processes things very differently. And so I tried to write a play that moved at the same pace as the people I was writing about. So it jumps around in history. It jumps around in time. You know, we get information. We meet Elon Musk. We meet Freud,
yeah,
all these different people who help inform the journey. So that's what picked me last. It's funny, it's fun, and silly, but I think also, you know, it's something that, you know, again, because none of us forget how it feels to get picked last, or some of us were team captains and have never gotten picked last and might need an opportunity to reflect on what that meant for others. So so that's that piece.
I have to say, I still have like strong memories of the who gets picked last, together with I spent about 5 years as a really fat kid. So like the shirts and skins moment in gym was also terrible. Awesome. Like that, please let me be shirts was a big moment for me.
Why do we do this to people?
It's a really rich play. I mean, there's all of this the themes of kind of allyship and standing up for what you believe. We do these, it's a new play every year. So, you know, every year we have this kind of development process, and usually the first draft comes in and then like the kind of hard work begins of bringing it into focus. Your first draft arrived and everyone in the artistic and education department read it and said, oh my gosh, this is like such a fully evolved play already in its very first incarnation. You've clearly got a real skill for articulating a great question to answer in a play and speaking directly to young audiences.
I appreciate you saying that. You know, revision is where good things become great things. And so revision is important. However, I don't like it. It's not that I don't like it. I actually really like it, but it's just, I can be a lazy writer sometimes. So I try to get it as right as I can the first time. So I do a lot of sketching. I do a lot of drafting. I do a lot of note taking, and I try to have it pretty well formed in terms of the story, because that's the thing about it for me is like, I'm a big story person, which is that like, I think as long as I know what the story is, everything else is easy to fix. It's just like, oh, that's not funny, or it shouldn't, you know, it should be blue and not purple. Oh, this scene's too long. You know, that kind of stuff becomes much easier to fix than like, okay, this ending makes absolutely no sense. Or like, why is this person here? And this doesn't make sense, or like, you know what I mean? Like, why is this person doing something completely different than they set out to do at the beginning? So anyway, I appreciate that you saying that to me.
Yeah, just like I was just going to mention, our it's exciting to introduce that process to young people, because, you know, I was a high school teacher, and anytime I had to get my students to revise anything, it was always like heels in the ground, right? Because it's like, it's done, it's a product. But it's really cool to bring this whole process to young people so that they can see that you don't just start with the play and do the play, right? And we, like all of our new play development, we have a reading for this play, a workshop where we bring in professional actors. We work with a dramaturg, Jacole led. We actually did a virtual reading earlier this, last year. We bring young folks into the room in that process, and they watch the first reading, and they give their very candid and honest feedback about what they see, which could be, I loved it, it was great, and here's why. But it could also be like, I don't understand this, or who's this character, or why did you do this? And that informs all of the decisions that move forward with our playwright and our director into making the piece. So it's really exciting to be able to bring that whole process into working with young folks as well.
We work with some artists who have beautiful evolved skills about how you collaborate and rewrite, but I also think that everybody secretly wants every response to be you're brilliant, you've done it, you're finished, right? So it's like, how do you get past that very basic human need of tell me I'm great to be able to work and rewrite and rework? Jacole, so when we first commissioned Pick Me Last, it was planned as a live in-school performance, as it has been for the last 32 years. And then 9 months ago, as every theater in the country did, we had to pivot, and we decided to do this as a virtual production. Can you talk about how your thinking about directing the piece has changed as it's moved into a kind of virtual world?
Yeah, I would say the thinking of the directing the piece has evolved more so than changed, because as you know, you all have talked about, as you and Bridget have both mentioned, that the pop tour is an introduction to so many students of what live theater is and their first touch point to live theater. So we really do want to approach this like a piece of live theater in as many ways as we possibly can. We're still with the set. Our Jonathan Gilmer is our set designer, and he and I have been talking about a lot of really cool ways to still keep some of that theater magic in there with elements of the set and transforming just pieces of the backdrop into instruments. And the way that we do things in theater, you don't necessarily have to do in film, because you can cut and stop and let's bring this in and all right, now start playing the music. And so this, we really are thinking of this as a hybrid between live theater and a film piece. And so the approach is really not much different at this point. It's really about really creating the best piece that we possibly can for these young people, doing as much justice to Idris's piece as possible, but then bringing in a whole new set of collaborators to help us make that in a whole new way.
Love that. Yeah, I feel like theater artists around the country are kind of carving out this new art form, which is part theater, part film, and different people approach it so differently. But it's, I think that art form is going to survive this moment, right? I mean, I think people are going to work live into film, back to live, in a way that like there's muscles that are going to continue on into the after times.
Yeah, I absolutely think so too.
Yeah, and there are other live elements that we will be adjusting as well, that we love as part of the tour, which is, you know, the students getting a chance to ask the actors questions after the show. A teaching artist usually visits their classroom pre-show to talk about the piece and do some theater exercises with them. So we're going to be pivoting to a digital platform, capturing interviews with our creative teams, putting lesson plans up for teachers to do with students ahead of time and after they see the show, and also developing sort of like an opportunity for students to interact in that live way where they can ask their questions and get feedback too. Because again, it's still a process and we want to hear what they think throughout the whole thing.
Love that. Question for Idris and Jacole. The main character in Pick Me Last often talks about how he hears music in his head, sort of coping mechanism. Can you talk about how music is incorporated into the show and the design?
Idris, why don't you talk about what you wrote in, and then I'll talk about how I'm going to bring that to life.
Yeah. Just the character Wes is a music lover like myself, and that is just where he sort of very early in his life finds his comfort, and particularly Afrobeat music he really loves. I think beyond that, you know, I tend to think of theater or think of plays. Sort of, I don't want to say like sheet music, but I think about them as, you know, it's sequential. It's like, it's got a pace and it's got a rhythm to it. Every play has a different just pace that's just baked into the page. And so there is also a very, I won't say, and they break out in the rhyme. That's it too. That's what I was about to say. They break out into like, you know, rhyming pieces that could be taken in a lot of different ways. But, you know, for me, it's a very energetic piece. And so it's sort of just like it's in the fabric of it. But it's open for a lot of different kinds of interpretation, like different types of creative teams could push it in different directions if they wanted to.
Well, one of the things that attracted me the most to this play, and I have to, like, going back to what Chris said, as far as it being such a complete draft when we first got it, I don't know when we had that draft. I wasn't signed on immediately as the director, but the more we started going through this piece and it started to develop, at the time, Julia Cuppy was the director of education. I was like, you know, Julia, I really think that this piece needs a Black female director. We should really be thinking about a Black female. And, you know, I think this piece really needs somebody who lives in that spoken word world, you know, who really has an affinity for that kind of rhythm and that as an art form. And, you know, I think you should really have somebody who knows the pop tour, who has some history with. And then she was like, you know what, Jacole? What about you as director? Me? I hadn't thought about, are you me? Okay, you know, but I was so attracted to this piece because of all of the elements and the musicality. Because yes, the music lives in Wes's soul, and he uses music as an escape from all of the chaos of his world. But the story is told really from Siobhan's perspective, and we meet these characters. We meet Freud. We meet Elon Musk. But they're all from the perspective of this, you know, fourth grader and this 10-year-old. Almost everything that we see is contrived through the mind of Siobhan. And the fact that these characters do randomly just break out into rhythm and beat and spoken word, it just, that means that that lives at her core. It's in the fabric of this character, which makes it into the fabric of the piece itself. So I think that music is so interwoven in it. And again, as we ask this question to the students, like we said in the workshops that we do, we ask, how is music used in the piece? And they couldn't necessarily identify with Wes, and they didn't grab onto that, but they did grasp on to that change in rhythm. The fact that there was something different about this style that they were using to tell the story. And it was really exciting.
I love that. When you're talking about how you came to be the director, it reminds me that what it's true in school and it's true in life, it's all about raising your hand. Like, it's all about saying, I could do that. Idris, you write plays for both adults and youth audiences. Do you think about the process of writing those plays differently? Is it the same thing, just with a different intent? How do you think about those two kinds of plays you write?
You know, they're very kind of like intuitive differences for me. Nothing I can really sort of say like concrete, like, oh, I make sure there's dogs in my place for kids, because adults love dogs too. And here's the thing about it. You know, kids don't go to the theater by themselves. You know, there's an adult with them, and that person's watching it too. So, you know, it's like just different meals. It's like different food, you know, like there are certain meals that you serve, you know, a middle-aged person, and there are certain meals you, you know, you serve a five-year-old, but you'd be surprised. But then there, and then there's the things that like all ages love, like pizza, you know? So I just look at it as like, it depends on the story. It depends on the intent. It depends on the space. It depends on the age. You know, there's all these little nuances. Like 5 years old is different than 8 years old. Is different than 12 years old. And I've kind of written for all different ages at this point. And so, you know, I think it's just trying to have some kind of understanding of the palette of where folks are at, you know, and, you know, what, you know, just like what is going to make the sort of taste buds wake up, you know? I have a 1.5 year old who like loves, he loves bread. And I remember my first son loved bread and who, you know, just cause it's, you know, it's soft and it's kind of sweet and they got teeth coming in and all this kind of stuff, you know? So it's that kind of similar understanding of like, where are they at in their lives? What are they interested in? What are they drawn to? And how can I make the story make sense? How can I make the bite make, you know, elicit some kind of response based on where they're at, you know? So that's really the work of it, is just trying to calibrate all that. But to me, story is a story, you know, and really a good story should be able kind of to work kind of broadly across multi generations. And really that's where I'm trying to really evolve my writing now, is like, I really want to just be known as like a multi-generational writer. And really I want the 5-year-old and the 8-year-old to both enjoy the evening in the theater, or the afternoon in the theater, or the, you know, the theater they're watching on their screen, I guess is probably more accurate. You're muted, Chris. Chris, you're muted. Chris, you're muted.
That's the most frequently stated sentence of 2020. I'm glad to hear it in 2021. I think we have a little bit of video of from Say My Name, of a piece that Idris wrote and performed in. Let's take a look at the video.
Oh, you want to see? Are we here? You want me to set it up?
You want to set it up? Go for it.
Hello. I'm well, how you doing?
Good.
Could I have a black coffee, please, to go?
Yeah, sure. What size do you want?
Yeah, that's perfect.
Great. What's the name?
Idris.
Can you say it again?
Idris.
Great.
Thank you. I always thought the name came out of a book. My mother still has it. It's crude and it's orange and it says African names. Now inside African names, it says something like Idris means immortal, but I don't think that's right. My mother's name is Patricia. My father's name is Donald. Their parents are named Thelma, James, Ruth, and also James. They wanted us to have names with throat and vowels. In Detroit, the name was a minority. The black church asked, why you get that boy that Muslim name? Why you get that boy that African name? There are names in the good book, strong apostle names. There are names in the phone book, strong regular names. In the suburbs, the name was a minority. My middle American classmates asked, now is it Idris, is it Iris, is it Ivan, is it Isidore, is it Ivan, is it Iggy? How about I just call you I? Can I just call you E? Can I just call you something other than your name? Age 11, I asked my mom if I can change my name to something else. Mark, Tony, Sean, something else. Being named Idris in North America will arrest people. You must grow patience. That's so unusual. What an exotic name. It sounds Turkish, it sounds Greek. Are you Muslim? Age 16. Two Arab dudes come through my register. They get big eyed when they see my name tag. They're curious, how did the name make its way to a Target in suburban Michigan? They're disappointed when I tell them about the book, African Names. Some 10 years later, I'm in the Middle East where they pronounce it beautifully. Not all straightened and flattened, they've given it a joyful bounce. Idris is a prophet in the Quran. age 20. I'm new to Chicago. I'm cleaning cigarette butts out of a restaurant urinal for minimum wage. My boss is a giant stereotype of a man in a turtleneck, sport jacket, dark glasses, and a thick as Mike Ditka's mustache Chicago accent. He unzips at my urinal, the one I just cleaned, and then he says, I ain't gonna remember that name of yours. How about I just call you Eddie? And my name became Eddie. But then his assistant suggested he stop for fear I might claim cultural insensitivity. The gentleman from the UK tells me the Welsh have a myth. There's Morocco's Moulay Idris, the jazz world's Idris Muhammad, television's Idris Elba. How do you say it? That's so unusual. What does it mean? Prophetic cashier. What does it mean? Philosophic cleaner of urinals. How do you say it? That's so exotic. How do you say it? How do you say it? How do you say it? I call myself Idris, like my mama says it. She's probably not saying it right.
Love that.
Yes.
So good. We didn't get you a chance to set it up. Anything you want to post set up on that or say about it?
There's nothing to set up.
Hey, we've got some really interesting questions in the chat. Elise Smith Cooper asks, Idris, can you speak to your process that how you access an intuitive process in creating a play, please?
Go ahead. Well, so we talk about, like, when we talk about with writing, you know, we use this term finding your voice, right? And I think that's key. But really it's also about finding your flow. And by that I just mean, you know, what is the way in which you work? What is the way in which you craft, right? Because that's the thing. It's like all human beings are creative. But not every human being is a craftsperson, is interested in sort of crafting art objects out of their creativity, using their creativity to create art objects. We use creativity every day in a myriad of different ways that have nothing to do with theater or visual art or any of that stuff, right? So for me, that intuitive process is just developed over time, and you learn how to draw from it and you learn how to access it. And it's, you know, and listen, outside of the process of making art, it's important, I think, for all of us to get to know ourselves, you know, self-discovery, self-reflection, all of that is key and critical, I think, just to navigating life. As a creator, as a craftsperson, you know, you start to learn yourself and learn, okay, what is it that I'm passionate about? Okay, what am I curious about? Okay, how do I transform that curiosity into a dramatic question? Okay, now that I've done that, where's my personal connection with this story, right? And then you kind of go from there. But to me, that's the real important first couple steps, is that it's got to stem from you and where you're at, what you're going through, what you think about. Like, you've got to be in there somewhere. Because I think that's what makes it unique and unlike anything anyone else does.
I love that. We've commissioned you to write another play with the Playhouse. Cool. So we were yesterday talking about subjects for other plays that you want to write. Yeah. Do you want that play or other plays? Like, what are you thinking about now? What are you chewing on? What do you think some of the next stories you want to tackle are?
Well, I'll start just first, like, with stuff I'm just also working on. So one of the things I'm working on, it's actually really exciting. It's with Actors Theater Louisville. It's a play called Ali Summit that was originally commissioned to be a pretty straightforward, like, play, right, about this historic event that happened in the summer of 1967, where a group of prominent Black athletes got together to talk about Muhammad Ali's choice to not serve in the Vietnam War because of his religious beliefs. It's what it's become is it's going to now become a VR experience. So I just got an Oculus, and I've been stepping into the VR world, which is blowing my mind. And so I'm writing this as an experience now for a VR platform, which is really fun. Wow. And terrifying and totally unknown, but really exciting. So working on that, working on a play for Milwaukee Rep called A Parental Advisory, which is really about the history of obscenity and the burning question of what age is it appropriate to play Wu-Tang for your child. And it's about an MC, a rapper about my age, about my height, who in the middle of a concert starts thinking about obscenity and this question of obscenity. And so that I'm working on that play right now, currently too, working on a play called Beyond the Crossroads for your fellow San Diegoians at San Diego Rep, which is like kind of a choose your own adventure type Zoom experience. Working on that with another writer named Quinn Marchman. So lots to do. Also, yo, because of the craziness of 2 days ago, I'm also very quickly organizing a reading of my play, The Raid, which is about John Brown's failed insurrection at Harper's Ferry in 1859 and his attempts to get Frederick Douglass involved. And so we're putting that together lightning fast because I feel like it just, that play is just in my brain, you know, thinking about the events of a couple of days ago and just that history. And very much like that is just in our lineage. There's so many incidents of that, and we don't, you know, and so the president comes out and says, you know, hey, this is not who we are. It's like, kind of is, you know what I mean? We got to look at that. We got to wrestle with that. So I say that to everyone because we're really hoping, we want to make it available for the whole nation to watch and just cathart, if that's a word. So that, and then yes, currently trying to pitch you all on this idea that I want to write for you all, which is, you know, this, I've always loved Christmas plays and like holiday plays, you know, just any of it, not even just plays, like TV, film, all of it. I love Christmassy holiday kind of stuff. I also really want to write another romantic comedy. I tried my hand at that with a play I have called The Realness, which was like kind of a love story set in like the late 90s kind of hip hop world of the Midwest. I want to do another one of those because things are so sad and dark. I also just think that there's not enough really great like holiday options. Like we do Carol, we do Nutcracker, we do Santa Land Diaries, and you know, and those are fine, but you know, we need some other stuff. We need some more contemporary stuff. So I want to write a piece, a holiday piece that's a romantic comedy, but that's set in 2020. That is like, this was a very bizarre year and brought up a whole lot of other conflicts and challenges in celebrating. You couldn't see your family, you know, you're dealing with, you know, students, people like seniors, you know, senior students in their senior year, heading into their senior year or thinking about beyond. And there was just a lot of emotions. And so I want to explore that too. And also I just want to find a way to work some hip hop in it too. So, yeah, that is my pitch, for you all, but we'll see.
I love that piece. And I feel like it needs a black female director who really loves Christmas and also lived through 2020 and loves hip hop. I mean, I don't know if you can find her.
I don't know. But we could, let me go on Twitter.
I think that's what this piece needs.
Let me just tweet it out.
I love it.
Jacole. Wait a minute.
You're wait, me? I wasn't even thinking about me. I mean, but if you feel like it's right.
I think we'll talk. Your people call my people.
I love it. Hey, Bridget, could you talk to us a little bit about some of the other virtual work that's coming out of Education and Outreach Department?
Yeah, so we obviously miss being in the physical classroom space this year and working with young folks. And we've missed working with our adult students and our Spotlight On program in the same rooms. But we have pivoted. There's an image there from a couple summers ago with our adult students, but we have been able to host several different versions of our Spotlight On class virtually. I've been so impressed Not just with our adult learners, but obviously our kid learners are like pros at this now because they've been doing it for a while. But just in folks' passion and desire to want to be creative, especially during difficult times. And so it's been really exciting to be able to host not only our summer programs last summer virtually, but our Spotlight On programs. And then we've been creating just in conversation with our educator community resources for them on how to bring theater into their virtual spaces. As we mentioned earlier, Idris was part of our Play Where You Are series, where we brought 8 TYA, so that's Theater for Young Audience, playwrights in to write some original plays for teachers and students to perform in their virtual classrooms. And we've also created something I'm really excited about, a set of tech theater curriculum. So a high school or a middle school teacher now has lesson plans and really rich opportunities to bring the technical side of theater into their classrooms. That could work for a theater teacher, but just any teacher who wants to think about the different elements of theater. We had an opportunity towards the beginning of our pandemic time to actually film all of our production staff, our amazing production staff in their spaces that they work in, and then create a set of videos for teachers to use with their classrooms to introduce them to these different roles and jobs in professional theater. So I want to cue up a video of our very own props supervisor, Deb Hatch, who's amazing. And she's in a really cool space that not a lot of people get to see. So I'll let you see it. I don't want to give too much away. So let's show that video of Deb.
This is our chair room. It's probably my favorite room. And it's because it's just filled with beautiful chairs on display. And I can actually bring a designer in here and we can actually see what chairs we have. This is an amazing bonus of having a complete chair room. And I will say that we also have to buy chairs for just about every play. However, we can get them the kind of style of chair that they need for rehearsal, and then decide again what the show chairs are going to be. This is a really good example of some different chairs that we tried for Diana. And then we ended up buying 12 of them from Home Depot and reupholstering them.
I mean, that's a pretty cool space. I mean, if you walk into our prop warehouse or even that room that's just full of chairs. and so, you know, if you come to a tour at the Playhouse, you would get to see that and hang with Deb. But what's really cool is now we have all of this documented footage of our behind the scenes spaces. And we're hoping that that could ignite some excitement in young folks. I mean, even young people, when they walk in that chair room, are like, what? That's a lot of chairs. And so all of our resources and materials are on our website. We have a tab right at the top. It says for educators. We'd love for teachers to go there, click on it, peruse around. We have video content they can use with their students. So it's really been an interesting time to be working in theater education, but an exciting time to be able to really talk to educators and find out, hey, what do you need right now while you're doing all this juggling, teaching in a digital environment.
I love that. Hey, I want to point out, if you've been looking at the comments feed, Idris, you got a lot of love for your idea for a commissioned play. There was like already a little wave of affection and an audience building already. So Gabe, you want to join us back? Let's take some questions from the audience.
Yeah, absolutely. Hello again. And thank you. So many comments, so much love, so many friends populating our chat feed. Steve McCormick, who ran our education and outreach department for so many years and stewarded so many pop tours with such a loving, guiding hand. To you, everybody, so many other people, thank you for commenting. Throw more questions in. There is another from Elise Smith Cooper, who is also, in addition to being a fantastic artist, a member of the Playhouse Leadership Council, a guest on a past virtual coffee with the Playhouse discussing Spit and Truth, Spit and Truth, while Light Leaping to the People. So Idris, she asks, how do you like approaching issues of ageism and sexuality?
I mean, I think that you have to take into account all of the what the reggae artists call the isms and schisms. I think that there are, you know, we are in such a moment such a moment where there needs to be a great focus and recognition of the importance of intersectionality and coalition building. And, you know, I get in these conversations a lot about race and anti-racism and things like that. But even within that, there are multiple intersections, right? So there's race and religion, there's race and gender, there's race and sexuality, there's race and region, there's race and age. I mean, there's all these different intersections. So, you know, for me, you know, I'm interested in, I start first with people and relationships and what they want and what they're after. And then if I'm doing my work like I'm supposed to be doing, you know, all the isms and schisms that play out into the way in which they live and experience the world will come to fore in the way that they should. And those things come to fore in so many other ways. Like there's race and housing, there's gender and employment, there's healthcare and class. I mean, you know, it's there's so many levels and layers to it. And so for me, it's just about like, what is the story? What is the trajectory? And what is the way in which the isms and schisms become a deterrent or become an advantage or present an opportunity or complicate the situation? So again, if I'm doing my work as a student of humanity, you know, I just try to stay hip to everything that's going on, all the isms and schisms and the way that they're playing out in this particular moment where I'm alive, but the way that they've played out historically. And I also recognize my own blind spots, biases, and this is where, this is one of the good things about theater is that it is collaborative. And so when you got the right people in the mix and the right people in the room, you can talk about those things and wrestle with those things as we did, as Jacole and Bridget and I did, you know, with even with this piece, you know, so, you know, that's the job, you know, and you don't always quote unquote get it right. You know what I mean? You just make your best effort and you try to learn as much as you can. You gauge the audience as well, you know, and everyone's going to see it differently. Some people see the isms and schisms and some people don't, you know, so it's a process.
I want to piggyback on something you just said. You talked about having the right people in the room and that essence of collaboration being so central to theater. What do I, opening it up to all of you, what do you look for in a collaborator? What is the essential component that makes a person the right person in the room for you?
I think one of the main things is just an openness to ideas. You know, to be a collaborator, you have to come in open and be willing to throw anything up into the world and see what sticks. But I also feel like at the same time, there is a like-mindedness or a general common understanding that has to exist. Like even bringing Blue Light Films in as an additional collaborator for Pick Me Last, one of the most exciting things about that collaboration is that they're filmmakers, but almost everyone on their team has a background in theater. So they 100% understand what it is that we're trying to do. So we come in with that common understanding, and now we can just start throwing ideas up and getting excited and seeing what we can yes and run with. So openness and being willing to meet on a common ground, I think, is the most important part.
I want to pick up on that because I love what you just said, Jacole. And also I think the opposite, like I think so much of what the collaboration building is balance of opposites. Maybe mm-hmm. So like-mindedness is such a crucial thing, and also difference, right? And it feels like when we put a group together, like you want people who are perfectionist and detail-y, and you want people who are messy and just ideas and getting, you know, thrown out there. It's like you want opposites in creative tension with each other in a group. And you know it when you see it. You know, like, that group of people, they're going to challenge each other and they're going to listen to each other and they're going to create something greater than any of them individually would have made.
And then on top of that, you're absolutely right. I think that's what makes me and Becca Duhame, our associate production manager, such a good team. Because I'm like, we'll make it work. We'll just do the things. And she's like, well, there's this, this, and this. I'm like, yeah, cool. We'll make it work. But we trust each other. And I trust her when she says that's a really great risk. And I don't think that's a big enough risk, you know, whatever. And I go, you know what? Cool. I get that. But she trusts me as well when I say, yeah, risk schmisk. Let's just try the thing. Let's see what we can do. And we come from very different angles of it, but we trust each other. And so we're always going to find a nice middle ground.
One thing I love about collaborating with artists like Idris, especially, is the insane amount of creativity that goes into boundaries. And we like some boundaries in theater, right? Because then you can develop a new sense of creativity around that. But with the pop tour especially, it's like, it's got to be 45 minutes. It's got to have this many actors. You know, we want to hit on, we got to make sure that it's good for this kind of large range. I mean, a third grader, like you said, is different than a sixth grader. I was thinking about in the piece, actually, there's a flashback where the fourth graders think back to second grade and how they were such different kids then, you know? And so one thing that is so always like exciting and fun for us is how these pop tour playwrights work within those boundaries to just create something so magical. And the process of it, the muck of it, is really where the joy is. I mean, obviously watching a room full of kids watch a play is like pretty breathtaking, honestly. But I love the muck of that process and kind of working through those parameters as well. It's really fun.
What, Bridget, you're talking about that experience of watching the students watch the plays in the pop tour, that watching a group of people who, for many of whom, this is their first piece of theater, is, it's like why you do it. It's just like watching people's imaginations attach to the story and come to life, and the absolute focus of a first time watching a show is the best thing about our jobs.
My favorite thing in the world is anytime you're watching a kid watch a play, whenever the actors point to something or look out at something, inevitably there's going to be that kid that looks behind him to see what that is. That's how real we're able to make these worlds for these kids, that they think the moon popped up behind them.
Yeah.
And one more question for all of you. Idris, I'm thinking of you. Obviously, everything that we've endured over the last 9 months in so many different spheres have been dispiriting. But I also, hearing you talk about the way that you are able to, on a dime, assemble a group to recreate the realness, there's a hyper-responsivity in this moment that I think we didn't really have or didn't choose to operate with in the before times. Are there, for all of you, what have been the discoveries, the happy discoveries, the fortunate silver linings that have come out of this period?
I just how much more connected I feel. I feel so much more connected with my community. Like, I see people that I would see maybe once a year, every couple of years, only when I was in their city. And now I'm like working with all these people all the time, and it just doesn't, like, distance means something different now. And so the technology is really making it possible for us to move quicker in some ways. It's hindered us in other ways, obviously, but it's actually made the conversation and the conversation move faster, you know, and that's really exciting to me.
Yeah, I agree with Idris. And even though there are still great divides in terms of equity and technology and who has access to what, it's, you know, even with something like our teen council, which we have 30 members in our teen council this year who are young high school folks who have a passion for the arts, we've been able to reach students that maybe traditionally couldn't drive to the Playhouse, you know, twice a month for a meeting, but are able to in this digital space. And it opens new doors to thinking about how we provide access and opportunities moving forward as well, that we're all comfortable now working in this digital space, and it's a little bit more inclusive, and we can remove some barriers of geography in terms of getting to work with new voices in the room, which I think has been a silver lining as well.
I agree with what both of these artists have said. And to me, it's an addition. There's a level of truth and authenticity that is necessary now in both in our art and in life and in the way that we speak. And I think that there is now this shroud of truth that has been taken away, I think you know what I mean. And that now there is space for people to speak their truths and to, and for people to listen. And I think that that is, I think people right now are their most authentic selves. And even in our art, we're not accepting anything less than that in what we're going to be creating and putting on our stages or our screens, as it were.
Mine is a version of what Jacole just said, which is, I feel like we're being challenged by the politics of the situation, by the pandemic, by so many of the factors of this moment, to ask deep, major, basic questions of who are we? What are we about? What do we want to do with our lives? What do we want to do with our theater? What do we want to do as citizens? That, like, the questions are deep and profound and basic, and it's upsetting to be have to ask those questions, but it's also the opportunities for fundamental change are present in our lives and in our polity. So it's scary but exciting to ask the real baseline questions.
This is fantastic. We could talk about this all day. But alas, I think we're running out of time. So I just want to say to each and every one of you, thank you for sharing your passion, your brilliance, your artistry, and your super smart comments today. A real treat.
Thank you for joining us, Idris and Bridget and Jacole and Gabe. Thank you for sending us out. So, and I think we've got a little goodbye video, right? Do you want to send it?
Yeah, just a couple things, quick things before we do. As Bridget mentioned, there are numerous other fun online educational programs that the Playhouse has developed for students, parents, and educators, all available for free on our website, helping to bring the arts into lives of young people. And I want to remind everybody, if you missed a portion of this chat or if you want to share this with a friend, you can view this and past Coffees with the Playhouse on our YouTube channel and visit that and our website for all of our digital WOW programming as well. Finally, thank you so much to all of you who have joined us today, still holding in our hearts the hope to be seeing you in person someday soon. In the meantime, we're going to leave you with a video from a young performer's final presentation from a few years ago. Thank you again. Be safe, everybody. So long, everybody.